Добре, уважаеми колеги, дами и господа. Откривам първата сесия на конференцията. Тя е посветена на резултатите, които са постигнали до сега в Европа в областта на приложението на суперкомпютрите. Давам думата на втория медиатор, мой колега, професор Томас Липерт, да ви запознае с тези резултати. Благодаря.
Thank you. So, good morning, everybody. Good morning to our distinguished guests. So, good morning to all our visitors here. I'm extremely happy to be here together with my friend Stoyan Markov, very well known in Bulgaria, leader of the National Center for Supercomputer Applications. I'm from the Jülich Supercomputing Center. Both of us are in the BRACE Council and we talk together about BRACE. So if there is any question in Bulgarian, please address this question to Stoyan, who is the expert in Bulgarian. And I speak a little bit English, so if you have questions in English, address me. So it is about HPC applications and their impact in Europe. Why is it presented today? It's very clear that we have to look into the past. What has supercomputing actually achieved and supercomputing applications? And from the past, we want to learn. Now I have to find somebody has now stolen. No, it's here. Okay. From the past, we have to learn what we do in the future, and all these exciting news we heard today, of course, are related to that. So, I want to give in this talk, which I have prepared together with Stoyan Markov, several messages. First of all, we have achieved groundbreaking results in Europe with science by supercomputers. So we have achieved it in various areas, and the range, of course, many different fields. The problem is, we will not present all the fields today, but we will present some selected fields. It ranges from medicine to social sciences. And this has been achieved by leadership class supercomputers. These supercomputers have been among the fastest in the world, and as you know, this list is dynamic. So we started with many of them, we started out at number 2, 3, 4, 5. Of course, at a certain stage they age and then they run down the list, and now we are exactly at a point where new technology comes, which is extremely challenging, but where all of us now have to go forward again in the next round of supercomputing, where we have to help to construct those machines. And so we are extremely happy that EuroHPC is now coming and will be the infrastructure provider. So this leadership machines have been provisioned by BRACE. We hope in the future that all of these efforts that have been put in BRACE, the Partnership for Advanced Computing in Europe, will pay off and will pay further. We believe it's mandatory for success of industry and of science in Europe. Second message, without the support of the European Commission, all this would not be there. Yeah? This is very clear. So, the European Commission has supported the development of the infrastructure through a series of so-called implementation projects. We call them BRACE IP projects, started with IP0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. At the moment, we are starting with the preparation of IP6. So you see, it's a long time and a long periods where a diversity of activities have been carried out by 26 member states of BRACE. So we are nearly complete in Europe with BRACE, including Switzerland. Yeah? A very interesting, powerful group of countries and powerful group of experts. And by this, we have built up the competence, a circle of competence all over Europe. This is what the BRACE past has achieved and where we now want to leverage into the future. That's the second message I want to give. Now, coming to the agenda of this talk, we want to start with Europe's worldwide unique supercomputing partnership, just to give those who have not heard about this, and also the public, an idea what is BRACE, what is a partnership for advanced computing in Europe, and why is it a cornerstone. Coming to selected projects, so I have asked all the contributing computer centers, those people who have knowledge, the best knowledge of all of this, what works in Braze, I have asked them, please send me the one project, not more, only one project, which I can present here, which you think is worth to be presented. And you will see a quite interesting selection of projects. And thirdly, a final discussion, we believe it's a centerpiece to support the digital strategy of the European Commission, which is manifestly there with EuroHPC into the exascale era. So, Braze, Europe's partnership for supercomputing, we think it's truly a unique activity. It started out quite early in the early 2000s. There was the pre-runner, the DISA project. Some of you might know and might also remember the name of Victor Alessandrini, who has pushed this a lot and was extremely, let's say, interested for supercomputing. And the first ideas of Braze were coming from UK, so one of those countries that we will miss in the future. This was you, Pilcek Leighton. I just want to give you that it's always clear that without a name behind who is pushing it, things don't work. You, Pilcek Leighton, was pushing that, and there it comes. Then we closed in with a so-called HPC in Europe task force led by Kim Okoski from Finland. Now you see it becomes pan-European, all the effort. Then it came on the roadmap of ESFRI, of the ESFRI list. Then we made the MOU, France, Alain Lichnevsky, Achim Bachem from Jülich. Later, Achim Bachem became the first chair of Braze. It was signed in 2010, and Braze 2 started in 2016. So you see there is quite a track record of activities, and I just want to give you an idea why and for what these activities have been carried out. It's a crown, at least in this representation, it depends also always on the representation of Europe's HPC provisioning pyramid, and it is, because it's a tier zero provisioning. Tier zero means all over Europe can apply all potential projects. It's a Europe-wide peer review process and a Europe-wide contribution of sites. And then we have the national ones, and then we have the regional ones, and it goes down to the university. So we have an ecosystem of supercomputing in Europe established. What we are missing now is that all of this is a dynamic process. It goes upward. We have to increase the power, because this is exactly the essence of HPC and supercomputing, that the evolving technology requires new machines, new technologies to come in order to make more progress than we had so far. And that's exactly what this picture should give you an idea. The basis becomes broader, and then we have to get higher in performance. Okay. There's a timeline, I already talked about this, but now you see these two stripes, stripe one, and a little bit more heterogeneous, the stripe two. Stripe one is actually the Braze provisioning entity, the Braze AISBL, the Association Sans But Lucratif, situated in Belgium, that is doing the hard work of getting the provision. And there are the building projects, Braze IP, which have been funded by the EU. As I said, we are here now and we will continue. A lot of things have been done. So far, these IP projects that build up Braze in a variety of aspects have been funded by more than 100 million euro by the European Commission. It's a huge thing. It has built up competence all over Europe. Let me just give some ideas how this now looks. If you look at Braze as it is, you have the user groups here that can apply for computer time. All of this is then going through a scientific steering and access committee where hard scientific criteria are used in order to give them the computer time that finally runs on machines that are provided by hosting members. At the same time, general partners provide support teams that allow finally to improve the codes of those users. So this is more or less the circle of improvement that we have here, and at the same time, the IP projects funded by the EC put in their competence and their activities in order to build up this infrastructure for hiring and also in some sense equilibrating the competence all over Europe, because some are better in this respect, some are better in the other respect, but we should become all, let's say, finally experts in all those fields. So you see the machines here, we have at this time seven contributing sites, by 5 partners. The latest one that came to us was Switzerland. They are on different stages of age, you will see, but they are continuously replaced by new ones. So at any time, we have in Braze a machine that is in the top 10, because we have one in the top 10. So this was it's just also a question, who is our partner if we only count the direct European countries? At this time, we don't have one in the top 10, but Switzerland is in the top 10. This is one point. The other point is, soon others will be in the top 10. So this is a going on circle. But in order to become really excellent, we need to crown this by very big systems. And that's the reason why we want to go for the Euro HPC direct, let's say, involvement of the EU with machines that finally will complement what we have here. This is the future, pre-exascale and exascale machines. What are the achievements? I don't want to bother you with, to bore you with all these different numbers, but it's just interesting to see that a lot of scientific projects, also including industrial, have been funded. 16 billion core hours, 50 companies supported, 10,000 people trained, a huge capability of in terms of petaflops available on 7 machines, and 26 Braze members brought together. This is a veritable European infrastructure. The application spectrum is diverse, you see it. This is required, but in all of those we have top projects. And this is just a characteristic. It's broad, but it's top. And we have a lot of schools. What really counts is the number of young people that you train, that are involved, that create the future. So you see, this is just an exemplary picture of a summer school that was in Ljubljana. A lot of other activities that are related to schools. We have the advanced training center that continuously contribute with training courses. Altogether, 10 of those centers all over Europe. We have the SHAPE project, where the SME HPC adoption program in Europe takes place. So you see that there are interesting citations from the chair of the Industrial Advisory Committee, who says this is exactly what we need in order to get the SMEs in. I will have an example later for this. And we have our Braze Days, where we bring science together with industry to show the success of the simulations. And this is very extensive, goes over several days at interesting places. One of these interesting places of Braze is, of course, Barcelona. And you see, if you are in, you can sometimes also visit interesting places. All hands meetings of the IP projects take place every year. You see, again, a lot of young people, some older ones in among them, but mostly young people, and that's exactly what I said, that counts. This is Braze. Let me go to enabling leading-edge simulations for European science. And here, when I was asked to give this talk, I was thinking, this is so much, there are so many projects. How do you organize that? So I asked the centers, people I knew from the centers, look, give me just one example, each of you. So some said, oh, we have so many. I said, give me just one. People will understand that we can have can't have too many, but I think we have got together quite an interesting selection. And now let's start in alphabetic order, so nobody is, so to say. So alphabetic order means Barcelona starts. This is Mare Nostrum, but it has been the latest version installed in 2017. Quite a big system, as you can see. It is run through a network, which is called the Omnipass network, and it consists of, so far, two elements. There will be more. This is a sort of modularity that this computer will exhibit. There will be more, I think, this or next year coming in. And of course, it's a sort of icon of supercomputing. Everybody should read the new book by Dan Brown called Origin, where even the people who are working, and we have Sergio Girona here, are named in the book. So play a role and play an interesting role there. Okay, so this is not the science, but now comes the science. Here I got modeling gravitational wave signals. And you all know that's very important. Mergers of black holes or mergers of neutron stars or mergers of massive objects where we might not even know what they are so far. Yeah, there might be surprises in this universe in the future. But how is this done? The problem is you have to have a model. But the model is very difficult to get, because everybody who has tried to solve Einstein's equation once is obviously frustrated by that. Numerically, you can do it. You can build a model that would say, this is a signal you expect, and if you have such a model, you can put it in, and then you can try to analyze a signal. So it requires a lot of computer time on the Barcelona system, and it has served as template for the analysis of Religo and the Virgo detectors, Virgo in Italy, as you know. And this was very interesting. This was not the Nobel Prize, but I consider it much more important what was then discovered with LIGO Virgo, because this was a Newton star merger. So finally, what one can say, by simulation, you can create models for Nobels. This is exactly what happened, and so this is a very important result. Let's go on, next one. Cineca Marconi, interesting name, very famous. Again, a modular system consisting of different parts, but working together. A huge tape storage, as well as that before, and disk storage, etc. I don't want to bother you with the details here. If you want to know, you can ask the people who are from the centers here. Their most interesting, let's say, activity is a simulation of nanotubes as excitonic insulators. You might see, what is this? The point is, they have promoted and fostered a software named Quantum Expresso. It's very interesting doing quantum Monte Carlo studies for this. The only way to understand those type of science. Why is it so important? One can use excitons to probe materials. And if you want to understand materials, you have to probe materials. So these excitons are exactly what you need to understand, and they are very exotic ones, and they have a phase transition, and they want to understand if this insulator phase actually exists, might also be used to build, let's say, very low power transistors in the future. An old idea by a Nobel Prize winner, Mr. Kohn, it's but still elusive. We don't have it in experiment, but we have it in simulation. It was proved on the Cineca systems by ab initio simulation that it is realized. So now it is really time to look for it. If we have it, this would be a breakthrough. You see, there is a lot of things involved. There is an excellent sender Max involved. There is this quantum espresso, and you see here the phase transition. So you see the phase transition characteristic. At Cineca, we can say this is a forefront simulation. Let's go to the next one. Pistind, the Swiss system, coming to us a little bit later. Again, two systems with one network, so you can play back and forth with different technologies. They have devoted much of their activity to improve codes for the future use. Here it is climatology and it is weather science. I want to include convections that resolve the climate simulations much better on the kilometer scale with significant improvements on the diurnal cycle. You see the improvement immediately. If you go from the blue curve to the red curve, you see the blue curve and the red curve on a daily basis are completely different. But it's interesting that the red curve approaches the black curve very well. Now, these simulations capture the real diurnal cycle, the daily cycle of the weather. This is a breakthrough in technology. For the COSMO model, there are other models that it will be included in those models. It actually runs 2 to 3 times faster than on the fastest machine in the world, which is Taihu Light. It's much bigger. It's by a factor of 5 bigger, 4 bigger Taihu Light, but the code running on the Swiss machine is faster. Think of that. This means investing with brain power pays a lot. World record in code acceleration led by Christoph Scher from the ETH, together with Max Planck in Germany, as there are a lot of people involved for this. Just in this context, on the same machine, we have grand challenges, like grand challenge of drug design. Why do I show this here? Because it should give you an idea of the economic value of simulation. So we know that the cost of developing new drugs was about 200 million per drug, on average, of course, in the 1970s. It is 2 billion in 2010, if you scale to our value, currency value today. This means it has increased a lot. Also, the development time has more than doubled. And now the question is, can we really go on with classical search? It does obviously not scale into the future. Now the question is, how can you test more than 1 million drugs if each of those tests costs between 20 and $130. So the idea is, of course, to use simulation in order to reduce the costs. This is done by Novartis and with a company Schrödinger, that's a software company providing life science and material science software. The task was to test 21 million drug candidate molecules and with a new HPC algorithm. And the cost now was just for the simulation €10,000. Of course, the total cost is larger. You have people, let's say, working five people for 2 or 3 years. Finally, you have certainly a cost of up to 1 million, but it is still a factor of 1,000 smaller than we would have if we do not simulate. This is a potential that's huge. Maybe it's the only way to go into the future where medication for rare diseases has to be found. Nobody will do it if there is not just an improvement in the costs to develop it. Let's go on. Curie in France. This is a machine now from 2030. So you see, this machine served for a long time. This machine has delivered a huge amount of cycles to science. Yeah? That's important to know. Yeah? A machine that has been installed at a given time operates for 5 years and continuously 24 times 7 hours per week gives cycles to science. Again here, a machine with several more heterogeneous elements, but still already at this time going into a more modular approach. This machine has given me several applications. I have chosen one very interesting one. This is the biggest crash optimization ever. So you have Renault doing crash optimization with 20 million degrees of freedom, finite element measures with 200 different parameters. And the interesting thing is, this is in anticipation of new regulations. So people expect new regulations to come to certify those cars and machines. It was impossible to do this with existing facilities. And actually, there is a world premiere. They are now 5 years in lead concerning these simulations compared to their competitors. So what you can say is push competitiveness of European industry by simulation is certainly proven. There is a lot of activity in France also by TerraTech, supported by the CEA, where exactly those simulation technologies and applications are used. Another one from this field is Hazel Hen in Stuttgart, very big machine, the second largest in Europe at this time, is a Cray system. Here they have given me SME application. Interesting, it is welding, it's one of those shape projects. And it is insofar interesting, it's a simulation of multi-layered welding lines. Here you see the multi-layered welding. Yeah? And the point is, can you simulate and give you an optimized welding process for that? This is immediately economically valid if you can do this. It's a close collaboration with the Office of Welding in Germany and the LS Dyna supporter Dyna Moore within the GCS, the German Center for Supercomputing. We are partners here. The SME gained significant knowledge and experience in HPC is the conclusion, and they see high commercial benefit as to better cost estimate. You can say price brings SMEs to HPC. This is a given, it's one example, there are many of those. Let's go on. Let's go to basic science. So this is a U-Queen in Jülich, this is the oldest machine now in the concert. This is a machine where I'm responsible for. This was, so to say, a pilot. It was the first machine in Braes in 2010, the predecessor of it. The first machine, a petaflop machine in Europe also, and it's very highly scalable. And I got from my people interesting application where they believe this is, let's say, for the future generations to study. And this is actually an application from an 80-year-old riddle. The question was, what makes the difference between the proton and the neutron mass? So you can say this is basic science, but we did not know yet. Yeah? We know it now. Why? We can understand the mass difference by simulation of the fundamental theory. We call it in short QCD. Maybe you have heard about it, quantum chromodynamics, with the quarks and the gluons pictorized here. So the interesting thing is, 80 years after the experimental detection, the simulation of U-Queen has solved this riddle, how it is generated. And what you can see finally, this gives science reports and its results you will find in the textbook in the future. So what one can say also, for the textbooks of basic science, you will see in the future simulation to be the most important contributor. Let's go on. A similar activity now in astrophysics. And I would say, if I look at astrophysics, what we have here is probably what we cannot do with accelerators of the future. We have to go to astrophysics if we want to continue and understand the basic physics, because this is a laboratory we have to observe. And the laboratory here is a simulation of supernova. So that's one of the very important big projects also in USA, by the way, one of the first inside projects where the simulation of supernova simulations. And the question is, how from a supernova explosion does a neutron star form? This is one of the most exotic things you can ever, let's say, imagine. And if you want to do that, I recommend you to read an old book. It's called Frozen Star by Greenberg. It's a very interesting book because this gives you an idea what it would mean to be close to such an object. Being close to such an object is something beyond any imagination, but this author is able really to give you an idea of that. It has been addressed by most advanced 3D simulation. It has been using highly efficient, well-parallelized numerical implementations where the LRZ group, the Leibniz Rechenzentrum group in Munich, was helping the scientists to implement, and it was found a new neutrino emission asymmetry in forming neutron stars. It's predicted. This means now they can search for it, and we can safely say this is a breakthrough prediction because it now opens up a mechanism for new signatures, which finally will shed light on how this goes. So these were the parts of the success stories of PRAISE in the past. We want to go on with that, and we believe in the future PRAISE will be a centerpiece to support the digital strategy of the European Commission in the exascale era. We have two elements here. We have EuroHPC, we have PRAISE, we have the top infrastructure, we have the top science, and as you know, top infrastructure requires a huge investment. Top science is a community effort. Yeah? So you have both top infrastructure and community effort. And so you see why I now come to the conclusion. The one must be a top-down process because of the investment. The other one is, in a sense, a bottom-up process. And that's interesting. Now we have a complementarity, and this complementarity we have to bring together. We have the EU coordination and funding, the plans for a joint undertaking. I think 19 states plus the 18 states plus the EU makes 19 members. We focus here on acquisition and operation, on research and innovation. Here we focus on provision, training and user support. The ideal complementarity, the people are now discussing how they bring these together. I think that's the future in which we go. We have this declaration, we have foundation of PRAISE, and what I would wish is to go towards PRAISE next phase with EuroHPC, create an optimal synergy and complementarity with the EU supercomputing infrastructure, creating exascale technologies and spin-offs in the EU, and have a leadership and maintain the leadership of applications by EU science and industry. Thank you very much.
Благодаря, Томас. Професор Томас Липерт ще отговоря на вашите въпроси на английски, ако има такива. Аз съм човека, който ще отговоря на български, ако има зададени въпроси на български език. Моля.
So, questions. Please. You want to say?
No, you.
So this is a question of technology development, and for very intelligently and smartly, all of the experts say this has to happen in stages. It depends very much on the process of development, and it depends also very much on, let's say, the ongoing developments of integration of such machines. Yeah? So we think the plans are that there is a period between procurement and final operation. So expecting a pre-exascale machine to be fully operational end of 2021 after a process where it starts is not utopic. Yeah? Going for exascale, again, you have to start today, yeah, for further technology to develop, and then you have to go into a procurement process. It is also not utopic to say such a machine can be operating end of 2023, but there will be stages. So it is not just the date In my opinion, because with none of our computers, it was just the date where we started, it was always a process. Thank you. More questions?
Worse?
Ah, there is a question.
Okay.
Yes, it comes.
Morning. So my question is, how do you see the Bulgarian place in the whole exascale topic? No, I asked Germany. I know what Bulgaria plans. I ask for your plans. Thank you.
Okay. So give us an opportunity that both of us can answer. Okay. Yeah. So if I start, I can say that within the development of the IP projects, Bulgaria has played very early an important role. It was one of the important partners, the engaged partners, and did a lot of work in the IP projects that finally have helped build up the competency. So the primary role is to build up the competency in the country. Yeah, this is the first thing, which thankfully through NCSA and all the others has been improved in the last years. On the other hand, always competence flows back either through, let's say, direct cooperation, sometimes through exchange of people that for some time work at other place, go back. So I think that's a lot of important activity. In the future, when it comes to computer development, you know that Bulgaria, you know it yourself, had in the past a very interesting track record. And these things are not lost. There are many people who know how a chip works. There are many people who know how integration works and architectures are built. And here I hope personally that the Bulgarian, let's say, ingenuity can play a major role in a consortium building the future of machines. You will not buy it. These machines, you can go to Gray and Gray will say, we'll sell you one. Yeah? But if you do that, you are always 2-3 years behind those in US or in China that have the machines first. Secondly, we would not really support our economy, yeah, in that case. But if we build those machines, and of course we have to be better, otherwise it would not be good. Yeah? And this we can only do with the right people. Then we have the chance, finally, to contribute to the European economy. If you want to say a word to that?
Не, мисля, че не е необходимо повече. Само една бележка, че ние активно участваме в проекта на DIPES, т.е. Европейската система на модулни архитектури, която ще бъде, предполагаме, основополагаща и за бъдещето.
Modular architectures, which will be fundamental for the future exascale computers.
Please.
Amount of money people are talking now for Euro HPC is something like 1 billion, 1.5 billion, which is a lot of money. But is it enough? And if it's not enough, wouldn't it be better if I look at your PISDANT application to just put the money into applications and to put the money into acquiring machines instead of developing own European hardware? Just from the application point of view.
We will certainly do also this. Yeah, it is not so that there will be only European hardware. There is a competition and a field of, let's say, competition between the technology providers. But the major point is that we have the chance to develop a better hardware. It's not just that we put the money somewhere in a foreign machine. If you want to get on this level of, let's say, competence with a foreign machine that might be built in China or in Japan or in US, you pay the same amount of money. It's just irrelevant. The machines cost what they cost. I think that development plus procurement, this does not really mean so much difference, but it creates so much difference. Yes, yes. Okay. Unfortunately, I got this signal from the real bosses here that we have to close this first part of the session. Thank you very much for the questions. Now we go immediately on and I ask partners of the panel, the panelists, to come down to occupy those seats and to now go into the panel session. So, asking for Harry Burman to come down, for Ilyan Todorov, and Heike Riehl.
I'm wired up, I don't know.
Is Heike here? Please.
Yeah, it's open.
We are a bit early, but we have been advised.
Yeah, we are early. Yeah.
Yeah. So we are a bit early, and I fear that Heike is not yet there.
No, but did we finish with Kuselu and with Konstantin?
We changed it to mix it up.
We mixed it up. I mean, we have two presentations.
Sorry. Okay. Okay. Please three here. I have mixed up a bit, so I learned. Let's have Constanzia Alexandru starting here with her talk, and so we finally have also our panelists. I hope that you feel comfortable on your seats here. Yeah. So let me introduce Constanzia Alexandru. Professor Alexandru has received her BA degree in physics from the University of Oxford in 1980, and she got a PhD in theoretical nuclear physics from the Massachusetts Institute of Technology in 1985. She has held research positions at the Paul Scherrer Institute in Switzerland and at Erlangen University in Germany. Professor Alexandru is professor at the Physics Department of the University of Cyprus, where she leads the Lattice Quantum Cobodynamics Computational Lab. She is coordinator of several research programs, has numerous scientific publications, as well as invited talks at international meetings, and she has organized several workshops in Cyprus and abroad. She is the representative of Cyprus and at PRAISE. For the Cyprus Institute, she serves as director of the Computational Science-Based Technology Center, the CASTOR-C, and in July 2010, she has become the title of an institute professor at the Cyprus Institute. So today, what do we hear today? It does not work.
They have to upload it, I guess.
Yeah. Today we hear a talk about disentangling the properties of nucleons by large-scale simulations. Please, Dina.
Thank you very much, Thomas. Hello, everybody. I would like to thank the commissioner, Professor Markov and Professor Lippert, for the invitation to present some of the work we are doing. So what I will be talking is what Thomas called in the PI, the fundamental constituents of matter, and it concerns basic science, which we think is extremely important for motivating young people and the curiosity of humans to explore, which is a very important component in what we do in life and in technological breakthroughs. So, I'm going to be talking to you how to understand the visible universe and also trying to understand the dark. So we know today that the universe is made of what we call visible matter, and visible matter is everything from stars to planets to people. So everything that we see, it's the visible universe, and unfortunately, this is only 5% of the universe that we know today. The other one consists of dark matter and dark energy, and it's called dark matter and dark energy because basically we don't understand it. So the purpose is to really understand how the visible works and find ways to make experiments to understand the rest. So this is the purpose of this work. So I'm going to be talking about the nucleons and why the nucleons, because they make 99% of the visible. So if we understand the nucleons, we understand 99% of what we are made of. So this is the motivation. We also, if we understand the properties of these particles, we also can devise experiments to test for dark matter. So it also helps us to understand the other 27% of the universe. So this is my motivation why I really want to look into the nucleon structure. Now, what are nucleons? So let's ask this question. Well, this is the history of our universe. It started with the Big Bang. And at a fraction of a second, we have the nucleons. So these particles existed basically from creation. They're here, and then they built more and more complicated elements until we come here where we have the planets and the Earth. And how do we study this? So you know the atom, you know the hydrogen atoms, we are all made of atoms, right? And we know the structure of atoms because we do experiments, we jam particles together, we collide them, and we release their constituents. And by releasing them, we study their properties. So as we go down this scale, you need more and more powerful accelerators to smash the particles with higher and higher energy in order to go to smaller and smaller distances and see how they are made of. So as we move down this scale, you see we go to the nucleus, which is the heart of the atom, is surrounded by electrons, and by smashing them together, we release the nucleons, the protons and the neutrons that make the nucleus, and we can break them and release them. Okay, and here is my proton, which is very, very tiny. You know, you see the scale of the atom is 10th order of magnitude smaller than the hydrogen atom. And then you say, okay, smash the protons, and that's what we do with big accelerators at CERN. We are smashing the protons together. Can we release the quarks and the gluons that we believe make the proton? And the answer is no, because we have reached a level in a physical system which we believe cannot be broken. Whatever you do, how much energy you put into the system, it cannot be broken. And this is why this is a very different system and a very exciting system to study. It's a fully quantum mechanical system which is generating mass by interaction. And this is why we need new methods to study this system. Okay, so the nucleons come in pairs, the proton and the neutron that will make the nucleus of the atoms. And they have properties, they have charge, they carry what we call color, so you see the quarks inside the nucleons. And this is a picture, we can now take photos of the hydrogen atom, and you see here the proton. This is the proton you see now in pictures. Okay, so this is what I want to understand. Right, and how do we study this system? Well, as I said, we are smashing them together in big accelerators. And here I'm showing you a big experimental effort. You see big machines worldwide, in Switzerland, in CERN, in Germany, in the United States, in Japan, in China. So it's a worldwide effort, big facilities, billions of euros to build them, to study these particles. Okay, so we study them experimentally and we measure various properties. But to really understand them, we have to go on, and there are new experiments now being planned in the United States. The electron ion collider has been endorsed by the United States, and it will be the next generation of accelerators to study these particles. Okay? So where do computers come in? Well, experimentalists measure, theorists have to give them the numbers so that we test the theories we have and the models we have for these systems. And how do we do this? How do we theoretically calculate? This comes with the very biggest computers. And here I'm showing you the kind of machines we are using. And what is important to understand is that we need several different architectures to study this system. So you see here, we have Pistein, we just heard, the biggest machine in Europe. We do run on this machine. We have, this is the kind of allocations that we have in order to do this calculation. We are running on US machines. Titan is the biggest machine in the United States. And we are running in another machine that you have seen, SuperMOOC in Germany. And we do need all these different architectures. This is the important message I want to bring. And that's why praise is fundamental for us. Okay. So we do big scale calculations using these big machines, and we seek to understand very fundamental properties. So this is an artist's impression of the proton. You see there are particles going around, and we want to understand how mass is generated, because I told you that 99% of the mass of the visible universe comes from these particles, and it comes from their interaction. So it's a very dynamic system we want to understand. We want to understand the origin of the spin. How is the spin created in the proton? And this is actually the focus of this talk. We want to understand how these nucleons interact with scalar particles, because this is a signal of dark matter. So there are fundamental questions we want to address using large-scale computation. Now, this is a complicated slide. It has the mathematics. We do have a theory. Here, I can write the theory, and this is the beauty of theoretical physics, in one line. Okay, it's a one-line equation. To solve it, I need all these computers that I have shown you. Okay, so this was written down in 73, and we're still trying to solve it. And the elements that make this equation are schematically shown here. These are the quarks, and there are six of them. And three of them, the up and the down, or two of them, the up and the down, make the proton, which is, as I said, the most abundant element in the universe. Okay? So this is a system we want to compute using the theory which is called quantum chromodynamics, QCD. And how do we do it? We do it by taking the fundamental equation and discretizing the space. So instead of having continuous space, we put a grid because we want to do a numerical calculation, and that's how we solve continuum equations. We put it on a grid, and we put the four quarks, the lightest of the four quarks, on this mesh, plus the gluon, which are the most important fundamental degrees of the theory. And then we do a simulation. We do a simulation using the machines that I showed you. Right. As Thomas Lippert pointed out, having a machine is not enough. We need the programs and the algorithms. And this is extremely important. So, we have to educate the young people, and here are a lot of young people, how to program these machines. And I'm showing you just some examples where we have been in order that we develop our codes to run on machines like Uqueen and Pistein. And you see, again, we need different machines. So this is an example of the Eurohack that happened in Switzerland. And here is a table of our people. You see the young people here of my group being present and optimizing the codes. And again, a hackathon at the Jülich Supercomputing Center, again, where you see the young people here participating to develop the codes. And this is a graph showing you how important it is to develop the algorithms. Because if we did not do this, we would be in this red line. And you see the difference between the red and the blue, it's orders of magnitude. So without algorithmic development, this calculation would not have been possible. So it is absolutely mandatory to have educational programs to train the young people to program these architectures. Right, so let me come now to the scientific question that we were trying to address. There was an experiment 30 years ago at CERN where they measured the spin of the quarks that makes the protons. And our picture then was very simplistic. We thought we have three quarks, you add the spin, 1/2 plus 1/2 minus 1/2, it gives you 1/2. This was the picture. So 1/2 plus 1/2 is 1, minus 1/2 is 1, it's 1/2. Unfortunately, they showed that the result, the experimental results, was half of that. It was not 1/2, it was 1/4 carried by this quark. And this came to be called the spin puzzle of the proton. For 30 years, we did not know where the other half of the proton spin came from. So now, however, we know that we have a quantum field theory. A quantum field theory is very complicated. It generates particles from nowhere. So these are called C particles, or quarks and anti-quarks. And they contribute to the spin. This is very difficult to calculate, but we have developed methods to do it now. So after 30 years, and using the most powerful computers, we were able to perform simulations, and you see again different machines, UQueen, you see here, SuperMOOC. Then we fed what we produced, the what is called fundamental degrees of freedom, the gluons, into PSTAIN to calculate what we call the quarks. Then we put everything together and calculated all the components that we believe contribute to the proton spin. So after we performed this, we found all the numbers. It doesn't matter, we found all the numbers. And you see, this is a C-quark contribution, and it's not zero. So this is a proof of quantum field theory. Quarks and anti-quarks are created in the C. We measure them now. This is a proof that these C-quark contributions are relevant and important. So you see random numbers here, completely random numbers. You add them up, it's 1/2, as it should be. This is quantum field theory at its glory. The different numbers are different, random you may say. When you add them up, you get an invariant. You get 1/2, this is a symmetry. It's 1/2. If you don't get 1/2, quantum field theory would have been wrong, okay? So, and now we know who contributes and by how much to the spin of the proton. We have the valence quarks plus the C quarks plus the gluons. And you see the gluons are non-negligible. They have to be there to get 1/2. So this has been a breakthrough, and I'm very proud to show my collaborators that made this happen. And you see here the different contributions. The solid lines are C-quark effects, and you see they are large. The gluons contribute a lot, and this is the 1/2 missing from the 1/2 that it was measured in the experiment. So the problem is solved. Similarly, you can do the same for the momentum carried by the quark in the proton. So if the if the proton is moving, the quarks are also moving and the gluons are also moving. So you can calculate the fraction of each. And if you calculate the fraction of each, and you see it here, there is C-quark contributions, which are very large. There are gluon contributions, which are very large. You cannot neglect them. If you sum them up, it's 1, of course. It has to be 1. because it's momentum conservation. It has to be one. It's quantum mechanics. And it is one. But now we know who is responsible for what. Okay, so this is fundamental research solving a problem that was around for 30 years using the most powerful machines that we have. And of course, we look forward. This is a field which thrives on high performance computing. So we look very much forward and we are very much excited about the European efforts now to go to exascale, because we can tell you that if we go to exascale, we will understand much more of fundamental questions as compared to what we do today. And this is very exciting for us, and I would like to thank you for your attention.
Thank you so much, Tina, for this excellent overview over your work. In view of the fact that we have not much time, and in view of the fact that you will participate in the panel, let's have no question at this stage, and let's continue with the next speaker. This is Professor Joseph Kioseoglu. Joseph has received his PhD in physics in 2004, and he's actually a material science physicist. Professor in computational material design, has worked before in the Department of Computational Materials in Düsseldorf, in Caen, at the Universiti Politecnica de Catalunya in Barcelona. He has a huge amount of research interests, as I know, materials analysis, design, microscopic technologies, atomistic modeling simulations, interatomic potentials, and density functional theory, and elastic theory, and many more I just have cut here. Thanks for coming, and thanks for giving us an insight in your research. This is very important for European science, what you do. So we will hear a talk on tailoring properties of nanostructures through atomic scale computational design. Please.
Thank you very much. Just to take that. This one? I hope so. Okay. Well, first of all, thank you very much for the invitation. And as you can see, I'm going to present a few examples about material science, and especially nanostructures. And let me see how it works. Okay. Okay, first of all, I'll start, briefly present the methodology that we are using. Mainly what we are doing is to help experimentalists to analyze specific cases based on nanostructure, to investigate phenomena and to explain what is going on the material science. That's why I'm going to present some representative examples. I'll start with the atomistic modeling of gallium nitride nanowires with nanodisc, indium gallium nitride nanodisc, gallium nitride, aluminium nitride, coal cells nanowires, defects in novel 2D materials in arsenine, hydrogen diffusion through the palladium magnesium interface, and I'll finish with the pattern silver copper nanoparticles. Okay, concerning the methodology, as I said before, we are using mainly atomistic simulation based on in-house codes and LAMPS as for the molecular dynamics simulation, as well as we're using Monte Carlo also based code for atomistic simulations. On the other hand, a lot of simulations are based on density functional theory methods. We're using ABINIT, VASP, AIMPRO code, and I'll explain the implementation of those codes in the following. I'll start with the modeling of nanowires using ab initio and molecular dynamic simulations. First of all, the project was based on experimental project. The scope of the project was the application of group 3 nitride quantum dots as optical transducer for chemical and biochemical sensors. It was a European project. We are using indium gallium nitride in order to tailoring the band gap and to accommodate the large lattice mismatch and to different growth temperature between gallium nitride and indium nitride. That is the schematic of the nanowires that the experimentalists wanted to grow. The gallium nitride is base of the nanowire, the indium gallium nitride nanodiscs, and the gallium nitride barriers. That's what we needed to investigate. And that's an experimental image of what we had to optimize. That's a computational quantum quantitative Reichert-M analysis of the experimental case that we had to investigate, and we were able to identify the fraction of the indium nitride inside the nanodiscs, as you can see here. First of all, we have started with the possible shapes of the nanowires. It is well known that the M plane is the energetically favorable phase of the nanowires. However, we have seen experimentally many cases, many strange cases. That's why we had investigate all the possible cases that are able to grow. What we have seen by the atomic potential as well as by density functional theory calculations is that during the initial stages of growth, small nanowire diameters, the bulk portion of the nanowires is small compared to their surface. Thus, the nanowire prefers a more circular shape, the dodecagonal one. When the nanowire is getting bigger, the preferable facet, the M-plane, is the dominant one, so it takes the hexagonal shape. And after that, we had to focus on the properties of the nanowires, of the grown nanowires. As you can see, the nanowires with the nanodiscs by a variety of techniques. First of all, with taking into account the elasticity theory and the possible strain states of the nanodisc inside the nanowires. I don't have the time, of course, to explain everything. Those are the excess energies of the nanodisc inside the nanowires, taking into account the possible strain states of the nanodisc. What we have concluded by the atomic potential as well as with the ab initio calculations that we have performed, as you can see by the use of density functional theory, we have investigated several cases of all those cases of the strain states, taking into account almost 1,000 of atoms. And we have concluded, as you can see here, all those cases by that are investigated by density functional theory, the biaxial, hydrostatic, and uniaxial strain state. And that those are on frames the nanodisc of the indium gallium nitride. What we have concluded in agreement with the atomic potential calculation is that the energy difference between the hydrostatically strained and the biaxially strained nanowires is very small, and the hydrostatic and biaxial strain component must consist in those nanowires, especially below 10% of indium nitride concentration, which was the experimentally based case. And also, we have investigated the electronic properties, and we found the Weygand law and the Boeing parameter that defines
the band gap with respect to the indium content. Okay, now I'm gonna go fast to the second part, which is the core cell cases, the gallium nitride with aluminum nitride cells. As we will know very well, the low band gap core, high band gap cell configuration provides a strong confinement on carriers. And when we have the core cell nanowires, there is a large surface to volume ratio. The stress induced by the lattice mismatch is relaxed very well, so there are no creation of defects on the core cell cases, and we are able to produce very interesting configuration. All in this study, we had examined aluminum nitride cell with taking into account gallium nitride core by the use of molecular dynamics. As you can see, we have investigated the displacement magnitude, excess energy, as well as stress. There are specific interesting results with respect to the cell edges, which are stress-free, and the cores that are uniformly compressed when the cell-to-nanowire ratio is increased. We have investigated the specific variation of the lattice constant along specific direction in the nanowire, and of course the thermal properties, taking into account the cell to core area ratio, as well as the electronic properties of the configuration, again considering about 1,000 of atoms. We were able to conclude in very interesting results by the density functional theory, if you consider about 1,000 of atoms or more. Of course, we need a lot of computational resources to conclude on those core cell nanowires and to determine this variation of the band gap with respect to the cell to nanowire ratio. Okay, and now I'm going to briefly present the third part, which is based on the novel 2D materials. This is a collaboration. This was a collaboration between the University of Leuven in Belgium and Aristotle University. As you can see, I'm going to present it fast the results. We had investigated buckled and packed arsenine, and as you well know, the most important properties of the two-dimensional materials are the defects and especially the vacancy, single vacancy or die vacancies, as well as the stone wells configuration. The stone wells configuration is a specific defect where the bond between the two atoms is rotating, and it's interesting to investigate the rotation of this bond to see what's the influence, not only on the structural property, but mainly on the electronic properties, as you can see here, due to the fact that the pristine buckled arsenine has this band structure, indirect band structure, and to investigate the properties of the defects. And also to consider different type of impurities, such as hydrogen, to saturate the Dugling bonds, as well as Packard arsenine, which is a different two-dimensional configuration, and to investigate in depth all the possible defects and the effect on the band structure, on the electronic properties. Let's go on to the fourth example. This is a quite interesting example because it's based on a project. Yeah, no. Okay. which is based on a project that we had with a Japanese group and a group from the United States. It's based on this approach, which is well known that magnesium form a very interesting form of magnesium hydride. The problem is that when you have magnesium and you try to store hydrogen inside of magnesium, it's very easy to have magnesium oxide on the surface. As you see in the following slides, the magnesium oxide has a huge barrier for hydrogen, and the solution was to form this type of portals by the use of palladium nanoparticles, which give access to hydrogen to the magnesium and to form magnesium hydride beneath those nanoparticles, and to have this well-defined nanoportal schematic. This is already formed experimentally, and you'll see what is the procedure in atomic scale. First of all, the palladium, when it's grown, when a nanoparticle of palladium is fitted on magnesium, it has a phase transformation to a cubic form. And afterwards, we investigated the diffusion of hydrogen from palladium to magnesium, or from palladium hydride to magnesium also, and with comparison to the same path from palladium to magnesium oxide. Okay. As you can see here, we present the barrier that has to bypass the hydrogen in order to get to magnesium, and which is found close to 0.9 electron volt. And for the case of magnesium oxide, as you can see, it's much higher, it's about 2.5 electron volt, and which is about three times larger. That's explained how the nanoportals of palladium works, give a path to hydrogen to go to magnesium. As you can see, this is very helpful schematic of this work. And finally, the last example is the engineering binary nanoparticles, silver-copper one, considering the variation of the melting temperature between those nanoparticles, and considering a detailed investigation of the coalescence and what is going on with the specific cases. What was found, one of the most interesting results, was the growth of the coalescence of the silver, of the copper nanoparticles on the silver one, gives the 111 facets remain clear of any heteroatomic deposition. And not able to run this, but as you can see in those cases, the 111 facets in those cases stays clear. That's why they give a growth of a specific configuration that is very close to what the Japanese named Okidama type of nanoparticles, which has very interesting, very unique characteristics, And even it has been grown and it has been experimentally identified already. Finally, this is the very recent experimental identification of these Okidama nanoparticles. And finally, I would like to thank the collaborators from Gießen, Germany, from Leuven, Belgium, many collaborators from France, from Japan, from Okinawa, the Mukhlesowan group of Okinawa, the collaboration from United Kingdom by the use of the AIMPRO code, and of course, the experimental collaborators from Aristotle University and the PhD students and the postdoc that works in my group. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you very much, Josef, for these insights in your work. The few that you will not be on the panel, maybe we have time for one or two questions. So, is there questions from the audience to Josef? There is a question.
Okay.
It's Otno. Thank you for your presentation. I have a question with regard to the predictive capacity of supercomputing in the context of material science. If you have certain constraints about, can you design new materials in the sense that you define certain properties you want to have, and then you use supercomputing with all the equations implemented in order to design the molecular configurations the materials have to have. That should be in principle possible. So I'm asking about the predictive capacity of your models on the supercomputers to design new materials.
The capacity that will be needed in order to design new materials. In a form of unit cells, we not need a lot of resources in order to predict the physical and chemical properties of any type of compounds. The problem and the most interesting approach will be to predict structural configuration and shape of nanoparticles. I think that the future is based on nanoparticles, because you cannot imagine how much different properties you can have if you form something in a nanoparticle shape, in nanocluster shape, even in a matrix or without a matrix. The properties that you can manipulate, there is a huge variation that you may have if you form something in nanoparticles, and especially in the form that I've shown you, in the Okidama type of nanoparticles, or in core cell nanoparticles, or in core cell set nanoparticles, you can tailor the properties of the materials having extremely interesting configurations. The resources that you may need it should be, in most of the cases, I'm not able to say exactly the resources right now, but in most of the cases, we will need above 1,000 of atoms by the use of density functional theory calculations. Now, exactly the resources depends on the electronic properties of the materials that we have to investigate. But in most of the cases, I believe that the density functional theory will need more than 1,000 of atoms.
Thanks a lot. I think in view of the time, we have unfortunately to stop. But the speaker will, of course, be available for any questions that the audience might have. Thanks. Thank you again. Now, we are continuing with the panel, and we ask the panel to join here on stage. So we already asked, and you could already make yourself comfortable with the panelists, at least visually, but I will introduce each of them. Let me start explaining you a little bit what is the objectives of the panel. The